You, of course, have become the publisher of the New York Times. You've been, I think, busy at your headquarters down the street, working in the last few months. I want to know what it's like to be publisher. What does it feel like to be publisher of one of the world's biggest news organizations at this moment in time?
I mean, that's a big question. It's an exciting, consequential time to be doing what we do. I've joked to some friends that I have found myself wondering at times what it was like to be publisher in 1988 when your main job was to swim around a room full of coins like Scrooge McDuck, just count the money as it rolls off the printing press.
Oh, yeah.
But this is the time when it matters. This is the time when the journalism ecosystem is systematically collapsing, when the underlying notions of the role of free press plays in democracy is under attack, and so that makes it an exciting, worthy challenge that gets you out of bed every single morning.
And taking over for your dad, what kind of pressure is that?
I mean, I think anyone who would step into this role would feel a profound amount of pressure. This is a 160-year-old institution that has really served as the gold standard of a certain type of journalism, deeply reported, on the ground, expert, obsessively verified, independent journalism. Mm. And this is a time when, as I say, journalism is feeling pretty profound pressures. My father's greatest legacy, in my view, is that he inherited a great news organization, and somehow, throughout the chaos of digital disruption and the financial crisis, handed it off, a quarter century later, bigger, with a bigger newsroom than the one he inherited. And if I can meet that benchmark of success, then I'll have done a worthy job.
What do you want that legacy to be? What more than that can you do with the Times?
I mean, to me, this is an all hands on deck moment for anyone who cares about, not just the New York Times, but journalism and the role it plays in a free society. Mm-hmm. And, the number of working journalists in this country has dropped faster in the last 20 years than the number of coal miners in this country. And, I think that's one of many measures that we can point to that underscores what we're losing. And what we're losing, at the local level is, news can be the glue that binds communities, that builds common trust, that holds power to account. And we're losing that all over the country at every level. And I think we at the Times, and you just saw my colleague Maggie Haberman up here, feel a great degree of responsibility, to find the path forward for quality journalism, not just for us, but to chart that path for the industry. And it's one of the reasons why, as we've been accelerating our digital transformation, we're trying to do our best to share some of the best practices more broadly, and find partnership opportunities, because we believe that the world doesn't just need a healthy New York Times or Washington Post or CNN or NPR or New Yorker. We need a healthy journalism ecosystem that is doing all the things that we as a democratic society need it to.
And healthy means what? It means more reporters, not fewer. It means hiring, not firing. It means what? More subscriptions, not less. What does healthy mean?
To me, it means something really specific, and it's something that I believe is not talked about enough as we talk about the future of journalism and the pressures it's facing. So yes, we need more journalists, but what we really need, and I actually just gave this advice to someone, to the new owner of the LA Times. It's not about the raw number of journalists, it's about whatever number of journalists you have, giving them the time and resources they need to do their best work. So you can have three journalists churning out three pieces a day, for say a year and a half, and they will produce an awful lot of content without adding really any value to the world. Or you can have three journalists, just to pick three names out of a hat: David Barstow, Suzanne Craig, Russ Buettner, and give them 18 months to attack a single story deeply and produce the single most illuminating look at the President of the United States finances and where they came from that has been produced. We chose the latter path. But as was pointed out again and again, and this is like one of the sort of tragedies in how it's covered, is it's becoming increasingly rare for any news organization to be able to choose the latter path, to say, okay, it seems like you're onto something here, dig into it, hold on to it, like go the next level and don't give up. And we feel really fortunate to be able to do that. But I think when I talk about a healthy journalism ecosystem, that needs to exist, you know, on the ground in places like Providence and Multnomah County, Oregon, which are places I used to cover and where we've seen that scaled back a lot.
By the way, you have his more recent tax returns too, right?
You know, if anyone has
on that
them,
story?
If anyone has, do you have them? If anyone has them, feel free to send them to us. We will accept snail mail or email.
Okay. You have that locked room at the Times where this investigation happened, so I think you have more, but that's just my guess. All right, so you mentioned that the tax return investigation, and I think a lot of people are curious about your relationship with the president, your meeting with the president over the summer, which was supposed to be an off-the-record meeting, right? So you agreed to meet. Then he spilled the beans on Twitter about the meeting. Do you regret sitting down with him at all?
Do I regret sitting down with him? No. Yeah. I mean, you know, the role of the publisher is a pretty unique one at an institution like the Times. I believe that anyone who's in the news regularly needs to have some outlet to raise concerns. And I think that if you're a news organization, you're not providing some outlet where someone who, you know, is constantly in the news can't say, I don't feel like I'm getting a fair shake, or I feel like, you know, particular coverage, you know, isn't, you know, wasn't inaccurate or unfair, I think you're setting yourself up in a dangerous way. So I view part of my job as, you know, sort of being, you know, the last level that can hear concerns like that. So when the President of the United States reaches out, you know, I think it's, you know, part of my responsibility to take that.
I asked because he used you, right? He used you to claim that he's friendly with the New York Times and that maybe you even agree with the enemy of the people rhetoric. That's what his tweet implied.
Yeah, but we responded pretty forcefully. So, I mean, so I met with him under the assumption he would raise concerns, but I had a concern of my own that I wanted to raise, and I welcomed the opportunity to raise it to him directly, because I'm not sure how many people had looked him in the eyes, you know, from this distance and said, you know, I believe that your rhetoric isn't just divisive and it's not just irresponsible, it's potentially dangerous. And it's potentially dangerous here at home, and it is certainly proving dangerous abroad in ways beyond you know, what you may even know. And I was glad to have that opportunity, and you know, the fact that he chose to put that on that conversation on the record, you know, to me is probably a good thing, because if, you know, God forbid we do have, you know, more tragedies along this line, he certainly can't say that he wasn't warned that his words may have consequences.
Do you feel like he took you seriously in that moment?
I mean, it's hard to get into anyone's head in this. I mean, he certainly listened politely. He engaged, you know, with what I was saying as we were talking. You know, and said, you know, multiple times some version of, you know, I'm going to think about this. I appreciate you raising these concerns. But then a week later, you know, he escalated his rhetoric right back to where he had left it. And so, you know, I certainly don't think that there's anything in his behavior since that conversation that suggests that he's decided to act on those concerns.
Has the mission of the New York Times changed in the Trump age?
No.
Should it? Shouldn't you be a bulwark for democracy? I believe the Washington Post line is, democracy dies in darkness. Yeah. That implies they believe they are protecting the country from a darkness.
Yeah. I mean, you said two things. So should it change and shouldn't it be a bulwark for democracy? I'd say it hasn't changed and we are a bulwark for democracy. But I think that that's an enduring thread of, you know, the 160-year history of this institution. My great-great-grandfather, you know, when he purchased the New York Times, he vowed to cover the news, that the institution would cover the news without fear of favor. And I think, that sort of clarion call has stayed with us ever since. And so I actually think it's really important for a news organization like ours, you know, to keep our eye on the mission in a period of profound disruption. And disruption takes many forms. It's the rise of global populism, it's Trump, how technology is changing, how life is lived, it's, you know, how our planet is changing. But what is our job? Our job's enduring. We seek the truth, we hold power to account, and we help people understand the world. And we're just doing that with a different story right now.
Mm. And when you all screw up, when you make mistakes, as every newsroom does, do you think journalists get too defensive? Do you think the Times gets too defensive? Is that something
you want
to change?
I don't even know why you'd ask that.
This is one of the most common complaints I hear about the Times and about other newsrooms.
Yeah.
The journalists don't want to admit when they're wrong. They're too arrogant.
Yeah, I mean, look. There's obviously a grain of truth there. I think everyone gets defensive when they're wrong, but one of the things that makes you know the serious journalistic institutions of this country different is that we'll admit it, we put it in print. You know, we have a section of our paper dedicated towards
pages, the corrections page.
Yeah, to celebrating our mistakes. And the reason I say celebrating is that I think there's something powerful in admitting when you are wrong, because it's a form of holding yourself to account that sort of renews the daily commitment to do everything in your power to get it right. I mean, both of us have been reporters, and both of us, I'm assuming, have had a correction at some point. And it's an awful experience.
My editor at the Times used to make me sweat so bad when I would make a mistake.
Yeah.
But that was part of the process. Yeah.
And I think it makes you better. You know, I spoke to a group of college newspaper editors recently, and it must have been like 200 of them in the room. And I said, okay, like, how confident do we have to be to get something into the paper? Is it 50%? Is it like more likely than not? Is it preponderance of the evidence? Is it, you know, is it 90%? Is it 95? Is it 99? And it was fascinating to see how many hands went up at each number. Mm. And the answer, I mean, you know the answer, it's 100%. You have to be certain of something when you put it in the paper. And when you're wrong, that should be a really uncomfortable moment.
Right. Yeah. Do you worry that newsrooms like the Times and frankly CNN and others are losing a generation of customers who are buying into Trump's poisonous rhetoric? That they're not going to believe you, not just today, but they're not even going to believe you 5 or 10 years from now. You'll never gain them as a subscriber.
I'm not coming at it from like a business standpoint, like a generation of customers. I guess I worry about the trend you're describing, but I worry about two things. So there's, you know, we've watched over decades now this societal erosion of trust, mm-hmm. in institutions broadly. We've seen it in academia, in church, and in corporate life, and certainly in politics, and front and center is the media there. And then, you know, in the last 20 years, we've seen this like secondary trend of the polarization of trust. And we are now at a point where, according to recent polling, the majority of members of one political party answers affirmatively when asked the question, is the press the enemy of the people? And that is something I worry about every single day. Because, you know, an independent press is not a liberal ideal or a progressive ideal or a democratic ideal. It's an American ideal, and it's one that all of our founders felt really strongly about. And it's, you know, it is, you know, it's a baked in assumption in a healthy democracy. And, you know, if you're a small government conservative that's skeptical of, you know, of overreach, what could you possibly want more than, you know, a badass reporter snooping around for you know, bad actors, you know, doing bad things? And so, you know, I think as a society, it's really important that we find a way to communicate that, you know, that an independent media is in everyone's interest.
So what are you trying to do to communicate that? What are you doing at the Times? You've got some money behind this, right?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I think you're probably referring to our ad campaign, where we're really trying to emphasize, you know, both, you know, the importance of truth, mm-hmm. and but also to show a little bit more of the process. I think one of the things that you could criticize an institution like the New York Times for, and quite frankly, a lot of media for, is we do so much work to get to the truth, right? We do so much work to get a story, and then we hide the vast majority of the work. You know, I always use this example of, you know, one of my colleagues, you know, who had been covering Thailand for a decade, and he's sitting there on, and he found a dissident Thai general who is opposing a coup, and he found this guy and managed to get a who was sort of in hiding, managed to get an exclusive interview. He's about this close, and the general gets shot and killed. He feels the bullet go by him, the reporter does. And, you know, then we write the story, and I bet you know Times convention well enough to know that the story said, you know, the general was talking to a reporter when he was shot. And if you are a modern reader, and you haven't been sort of raised and groomed with all the sort of funny conventions of journalism, it would be a really legitimate question to say, like, why the hell am I reading this story by this reporter? I want to read the one by the reporter who is there. And the fact that it was the same person was disguised. So that's, to me, is like one example of, like, I think we have all these old conventions that actually hide the answer to the question, why should you believe us? And the answer to why should you believe us is the person who wrote about this has been writing about it for years. The person who wrote about this didn't just find out about it later, they were there and they watched it. The person who wrote about this had an editor, and that editor had an editor, and that editor had an editor, right? And, you know, and then you can keep going, our style book, our standards, you know, even our corrections policy that you brought up. There's all sorts of reasons why, that we can communicate for, like, why you should trust journalism. Mm. And I don't think we always make the case for the role it should play in your life.
Yeah, I've been out of the Times 5 years now, but when I was there, we did one story together. It was the Joplin tornado. We shared a byline. It was on the front page. I don't know if you remember this one.
I do.
So we're one for one, and on that day when we're there,
you're welcome back anytime, by the way. I mean, I don't want to make a job offer on stage because I think your bosses will probably get grumpy at me, but
you know, CNN's doing okay. I don't need the help. I do want to ask you,
it's
though.
It's for the best. We're failing, actually. I just heard that, so.
Well, actually, let me go back to that TV point, though. We're going to go back to that job offer. But about Joplin, when we're there covering the aftermath of this storm, I wish the people that think you're the enemy of the people could see you there.
Yeah.
Because, and maybe that gets to more than an ad campaign, right? You're doing a television show with FX where you're showing people in the field doing work. I just makes me wonder what we can do to help the rest of the country see that work, and not just the political fighting.
I covered the Great Plains for a few years as a national correspondent for the Times, which is when we worked at Joplin, and I remember that story well. You know, and I would often find myself in small towns in rural Nebraska or South Dakota, you know, or walking onto someone's farm, you know, 4 hours from the, you know, nearest stoplight, and have people, you know, say some version of, hey, you're from the New York Times, I've been told by the folks I listen to or watch, you know, that I shouldn't trust the New York Times, you're the liberal media. And I, you know, my response was always the same, which is, you know, when was the last time any of those folks walked onto your farm and said, I really want to understand what you're going through. And my job here is just to like be here to see what you're seeing, to hear what you're hearing, and to understand what you're thinking. And I really do think that every time I had that experience, you know, it changed perceptions. And I think, you know, journalism in the abstract can be made into a menace, but the practical art of journalism is really, you know, the art of, you know, of digging and listening and learning and empathy. And it's hard to demonize that.
Right, right. All right, so here's why I left the Times, all right? Hope this isn't offensive. I didn't think the Times was ever going to crack video, was ever going to figure out TV, was ever going to figure out this medium that that CNN seems to know how to do. Where is the Times with that today? Where do you see the Times going? Because frankly, you know, CNN and the Times and the Post, all these outlets compete for scoops. We're united in a sense in terms of press freedom. But I see these brands becoming more and more alike every day. Yeah. Do you see that as well?
Yeah, I mean, I think, look, I mean,
you have a podcast that competes with our morning show, for example.
I think that that was a really particular moment in our evolution, you know, from like a tradition-bound, you know,
print newspaper,
you know, to a global 24/7, you know, digital multimedia news provider.
Are you there now?
I certainly think that we are a hell of a lot further on that path than we were then. And I also don't think that path ends, right? I mean, I think part of, you know, our challenge is to understand that, you know, technology is not like an affront on all our best traditions. It's, you know, how you can tell stories are changing and how people are finding and engaging with news is changing. And you have to change with that. And so the podcast is a great example. I mean, to me, The Daily is, you know, is such a perfect example of what happens when you have something that has all the best qualities, you know, of the New York Times, of like the seriousness, the rigor, you know, the expertise, but also feels totally native to a really different format, right? So the informality, right? You know, the sense that you can hear smart people really pausing and thinking and reflecting and watching their words. I think it's almost impossible to listen to The Daily and not come away with the perception like, oh, these are serious people trying their best to be fair. So I think, you know, part of our challenge as news organizations, this is true for you guys as well, is to figure out what all these formats are for. What do they do uniquely? What do they do well? You know, podcasts are great because, you know, they're really great for a reconstruct, right? Like you don't have to have been, you know, with the story as it unfolds. Mm-hmm. You know, you can tell it like a good yarn. TV doesn't do that half as well, right? TV, you want to see the places and see the events unfold. So we're trying to crack that code now, and maybe we're a few years too late for you. But we have a new show on FX called The Weekly that's going to launch early next year. FX and Hulu actually, it's going to be a serious, you know, New York Times news weekly show that we hope will introduce a new audience and a new generation to what the New York Times stands for.
Yeah. All right, lightning round in our last 5 minutes. Okay. How big can the New York Times get online? You have, what, 3.8 million subscriptions right now. It's a huge number compared to other news organizations. How big can you get?
I mean, I think we're, I know you said lightning round, but print folks think in
give
long
me a
sentences.
Number. Give me a 10 million, 20 million, 100 million.
I mean, I guess like it's sort of like it's all of the, I mean, 100 million seems optimistic. but, you know, we are throwing numbers like 10 million around, and there's a reason for that. And there's a reason for my hesitancy in putting any number here. Mm-hmm. The market for paid journalism is fundamentally immature right now. And, you know, a lot of people have asked, you know, isn't it, or, you know, the president has Tried to take credit for the subscription growth at the Times,
the
so-called Trump bump.
Yeah.
But I actually think that the what we actually saw was a new generation of people who are getting way more comfortable reaching into their pockets, pulling out their credit cards to pay for services online. And I thank the folks at Netflix and Spotify and many other places for helping get us to that spot. Mm. And I think that that's now starting to happen with news. Mm. It's happening at the Times, but it's also happening at places like The New Yorker. I think I read somewhere that CNN is even thinking about a paywall. Is that true? So I'll put my journalist hat.
We think about lots of things.
Think about it. Okay, that's a good dodge. Okay. So, but I think what we're actually seeing is that this whole market, we're trying to create a market for paid journalism. And this is why I'm cheering on the growth of the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post. I think all of us are in the same place, which is we are trying to convince more people that it is worth paying money for quality journalism. And what does that market look like? I mean, at the biggest level, it's curious English-speaking people around the world, who are interested in understanding more.
What about New York? There's been an uproar in the Metro section. The editor said, hey, if you don't want to be here, you can leave. I'm bringing in new people. Yeah. You had to talk at a town hall about this. What happened?
Yeah, I mean, I think, so we hired a new editor to, we reassigned one of our best editors and change agents to take over the Metro desk. Mm. Look, Metro journalism, city level journalism, is systematically failing all over the country. Mm-hmm. It's the area where we've seen the biggest declines. And that's happening in our own city, right? So we've seen in the last year or so, we've seen the Daily News cut the number of reporters by half, the Village Voice go out of business, so like a classic old brand, and then a very well-respected new brand, DNA Info / Gothamist, also go out of business. I mean, that's a pretty terrifying whittling down of the journalistic muscle in this city. And our view is the Times needs to commit to covering the city aggressively. But that's going to require a change in approach. And we hired a change agent to try to figure out what that's going to look like. I don't have the answer for it. Obviously, our colleagues, in journalism organizations across the country are struggling to find the answer for it. Mm. But we're really committed to doing everything we can to finding it, and to the degree to which we're successful, to sharing. Mm.
And what about the idea that your opinion section, you get so much criticism of your opinion section, columnists like Barry Weiss and Brett Stevens, people sometimes threaten to quit the paper over to cancel their subscriptions over this. Does that matter to you? Do you want your readers to be challenged? Do you think your readers want to be challenged in this day and age?
I'd say a couple things. I think our readers absolutely want to be challenged. And we did one of those studies where you try to figure out like what the unifying traits of your readers are and how that's different from, say, a reader of, generic news organization X. And, the unifying trait for us is curiosity. Mm-hmm. And that sense that our readers are people who spend their time wanting to understand things they don't know about. And to have their views challenged and to push themselves in various ways. And so, I understand that, people aren't always always happy with, particular stories or even writers that we bring on staff. But I do think that, when measured in sum, that those folks have added a ton to our report and that the bulk of our readers have really welcomed them.
And 30 seconds left. Will you bring back the public editor, the ombudsman for the paper?
I can't remember. Do you guys have a public editor?
Don't do that. Don't flip it back on me.
No, I was just wondering.
We do not.
You don't? Okay. No, it's because, the reason I ask is it's become really rare, right? It's like,
It has become rare.
The Washington Post got rid of its public editor years ago. I think NPR may have one.
So you want people just to complain directly to you? Is that
well? No, I actually no. There's a thought behind it, which is there was this role that was created before social media,
right?
Before the rise, honestly, of a ton of media criticism. you know, which we're seeing from, you know, academic channels. You know, I think there's a five-person team at the Washington Post who's covering us pretty regularly. And before readers could reach out and demand answers directly from a news organization. Mm. And I think the notion that there was like one person who could be accountable for what the world thought of our work felt really old fashioned to me. And I was actually much more, I didn't mean to put you on the spot there, sorry.
Hey, Cena never gets tired of me. I'll come back, but only as your public editor.
Well, I was much more.
I think you need one.
Well, I was much more intrigued by the model that you've had for years, both at the Times and here, which is you're in a constant dialogue with your readers and now your viewers. And there's this sense that, like, when you mess up, you have figured out how to talk about that and how to own it in a really just direct and accountable way. And I just think that that's what our journalists need to be doing across the board, rather than sort of crossing their fingers and hoping that, you know, when there's some sort of furor out in the world, that the public editor, you know, won't write about this one. If there's a furor out in the world, it demands attention, regardless of whether or not, you know, one person weighs in on it.
A.G. Sulzberger, thank you so much for being here. Great talking with you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.